Hello. Good morning, children. We are in the last topic of this lesson, which we are doing, Block 7, the Mauryan Empire. Today we'll be discussing about Ashoka and his Dharma, along with it, the importance of Ashoka's Dharma, because these are both connected, Ashoka and his Dharma, and then what is the importance of the Dharma? So both are connected, we'll do it together. In our previous classes, we have learned about the features of an empire and administration of the Mauryan Empire. So we have understand that what is an empire and how it is different from a kingdom, and then we have understand that how the administration of the Mauryan Empire was done. Today we'll understand that what are the teachings of Ashoka's Dharma and what significance that have in the Mauryan Empire. The keywords will be rock edicts, pillar, inscriptions, moral conduct, welfare. So Ashoka is the son of Bindusara. If you start from beginning, then Chandragupta Maurya, the founder, his son is Bindusara, and Bindusara's son is Ashoka. So Ashoka was considered to be the most famous emperor of the Mauryan Empire. Ashoka was the first emperor who communicated with the common people of his empire through inscriptions. Before that, the others were done many other different types of ways to connect people, but Ashoka was the first to who did connection with the people through the inscriptions, means writing on the walls or on the pillars. So this way he communicated with the common people, and he did all this in Prakrit language. So but what happened once when he went on a war within kingdom called Kalinga, which is in Orissa at present day. What happened in that war? Many people were killed. Though Ashoka won the battle, but after winning the battle, when he saw that so many people were dead, he felt little bad. And that day he decided that he's not gonna do any more war. He's not gonna do any more war, and he tried to change his approach towards ruling. And that war was very bloodiest and largest, means lots of people were killed. So this changed Ashoka as a whole. And after the war, when Ashoka was walking through the grounds of the Kalinga, he saw so many bodies were scattered, and his loved ones are grieving for them. So he saw houses were burned, people's were dead, bodies were there, and all this made him such a shift in his heart and mind that he felt with sorrow, and he decided he is going to follow the path of Ahimsa, that means non-violence, no more war, and adopted Buddhism and became a Buddhist and pledged to wage no war in future. It led to the popularization of Dharma, or the law of pity. So what happened when he decided he's not going to fight any more war? He became a Buddhist and started following Buddhism, and then he decided that I'm going to preach Buddhism, and in that way the Dharma came, which is the law of pity. That means a law for the very low people, very low way of living standard. So Dharma is the Prakrit, it's a written in Prakrit language, equivalent of the Sanskrit word dharma. Dharma means, in Sanskrit, it means dharma. Dharma means righteous work. So in modern day, you can call it as a kind of a religion type. So what did he do? What did he do? This how did he spread? How did his dharma spread? And how did he make it popular among the people? For this, what he did is that he followed Buddhism and he preached Buddhism all over his empire. Plus, he appointed some people who are known as Dhamma Mahatas, who used to look after this Dhamma's principles, and they used to go and preach this Dhamma principle to everyone and bring communal harmony to his empire, to his neighboring empire, and to everywhere. They worked as religious and secular ground. They checked the moral conduct of people. They acted on sorts of censors of public morals. I told you, this Dharma is more of an moral laws, which you should not do this, you should not do that, you should love others. It's not a full-fledged Buddhism preaching, but it's a moral law given to the people to tell them what they should do, what they should not do. And then Ashoka started organizing big seminars type, council type for this Buddhism, where he discussed his Dhamma principles. Then he invited many Buddhist people to the holy places he built. He built many sanctuaries and stupas for Buddhist works, for all this. He invited people to come over, and he sent his people also to others' place to see. So in this way, he made public houses so that pilgrims can come and rest. In this way, he has started a following, like spreading of religion only, and peace, harmony, and nothing else. And Ashoka further encouraged again his Buddhist monasteries to promote this message in the foreign countries. Like when he was ruling in India, he spread the message to Nepal, China, Japan, Bhutan, Taiwan, and then Nepal, Malaysia, all the southeastern countries, plus these neighboring countries. And for this reason, you see, today also Sri Lanka is a Buddhist country. China, Japan, all these many are Buddhist countries. Tibet, Nepal, they are all Buddhist countries. Why? It is because of this Ashoka's spread of this Dhamma and Buddhism. And because of this, he built many monasteries which are known as Biharas, where monks and can come and stay there. Okay. So in this way, he spread the teaching of Buddhism as well as his Dhamma, the moral principles. So what are the moral principles of Dhamma? In your book, you will find that the five tenets are given, five basic principles are given. Here some more are given, but they are almost same. So five principles of Dhamma, or some principles of Dhamma, you can see as: one should obey and respect their parents and elders. Very simple principle. One should always love and care for younger people. People should live with peace and harmony. Elders should develop an understanding with the children. One should be honest, charitable, kind to everyone, including servants and slaves. There should be mutual respect among people. People should love each other. People should respect all the religion and be tolerant. Everyone should follow the principle of non-violence, that is ahimsa, and non-injury to living things. One should have a good conduct of character and should be loyal. So see, all these are general principles, or you can say general rules and regulations, which everyone should follow. And if this can be followed, there will be no disharmony between people. So his principle of Dhamma was for pity, very low people and very simple. And that's why it got more popular and spread. So in all, if we have to talk about today's lesson, it is like that Ashoka's law of Dhamma was somewhat different from Buddhism. Buddhism was a total religion, full religion, but Dhamma was just a part of it. Okay. So Ashoka's explanation of what he meant the Dhamma was that it is a secular teaching, more than a religious teaching. Believe in the God, worship the God. It was a secular teaching. Do this, do this, don't do that. This will bring good. So it's more of a secular teaching that Dhamma spread. And it was a liberal code of life which could be imported by anyone, irrespective of their religious beliefs. Just now when we read these principles, I think you can see that these principles can be followed by anyone, Hindu, Muslim, Christians, all. So these Dhamma principles are very common to everyone. It was just a moral code of conduct. So in Ashoka's edicts, it has suggested that Dhamma has been taught in two ways: persuasion and regulation. Persuasion means telling people and telling to observe, and regulation means making it regular thing that you have to do. So Ashoka always believed that persuasion works better than regulation. When you regulate that you have to do like this, people might do, might not do. But persuasion, keep doing, telling them, that works much more better. That's how Ashoka believed. So the conclusion of today's lesson is, Ashoka was quite successful in his religious policy and the policy of Dhamma. He was able to maintain peace, order throughout the reign, and no solid evidence of communal disorder was been found. And he was a very liberal and tolerant king. After Kalinga, he changed and never fought into any war, and Buddhism and the path of diplomacy and non-violence, because of these policies, he was considered as Ashoka the Great, a true non-violent emperor who loved his people as his own children. So this made him a greater king. Today's assignment: please read both this section from page 66 67 68 69, complete S3, and complete my learning chart in your content book, complete PQ7 and AQ 1, 2, 5. These are all exercise question. Do in your content book. Only complete PQ 8 and 3 in your notebook. If you have any doubts, please contact me. I have given few.